Tobacco's a, it's a way of life and a tradition.
I helped my grandson plant tobacco because I don't ever want to forget where I came from and how I grew up.
People took a lot of pride in that leaf, and a lot of hard work went into it.
I've got my two sons and my wife and farm tied up here, and it's turning dry, and there's likely that we may lose everything we've done the last 30 years.
Tobacco is a highly addictive substance.
In Philip Morris USA, we have a goal to be the most responsible manufacturer and marketer of consumer products.
Some would argue that the colonies wouldn't have even been a profitable venture for the British, but for tobacco. It was the number one export for the young country, so it was an integral part of the beginning of the United States.
I'd say it looks drastically different from what our forefathers and Indians grew.
The first actual recording of tobacco use was in the Mayan culture. Tobacco initially was used for medicinal purposes. It was used for ceremonies, rituals, marriages, cures. It was also used in Native American culture to make deals. Tobacco to the Indian was really a way of life. It was a sacred thing. Very little of the influence of the Native Americans went to Europe.
I know early tobacco doesn't look anything like we have today. It was a bush. It'd be multiple plants of it instead of just one single stalk. It's been bred and worked with a lot in the last 300 years.
First settlers got to Jamestown in 1607. They were going through starving time. They were looking for gold. They were looking for all kinds of things that weren't there. They stumbled upon the tobacco, which ultimately turned out to be the gold. And it became such a hit. The settlers in Jamestown began growing tobacco in the streets. Jamestown all of a sudden was on the map. Virginia tobacco was on the map. After the settlers became bona fide colonists and became more and more disgruntled with what was happening with the taxes, with the lack of representation, there came a bid for a revolution. Benjamin Franklin secured loans from France, used to finance the war for American independence, by offering tobacco as collateral. George Washington, America's first president, was a tobacco farmer.
Washington was more of a military man than he was anything else, but if he was anything else, he was a farmer. And of course, tobacco was the mainstay. It was the rate of currency exchange.
Washington Duke was a yeoman farmer, typical of the great majority of the farmers in the South before the Civil War. He built this frame structure in 1852 for his wife, and then they proceeded to have three children, a daughter, Mary, and then Ben, 1855, and then the youngest, James Buchanan Duke, whom the family called Buck Duke, in 1856. They grew wheat, corn, a little bit of tobacco before the war.
When I left all East Virginia.
He opposed secession, but when the war finally came, Washington Duke gets drafted.
There were a few times when the Confederates and the Union soldiers would get together in fellowship. They'd get together in the middle of the road and trade tobacco for coffee. But it was not until after the war, when Duke came back to Durham Station, that it really caught a fire.
Duke comes back from the war penniless, but he does something atypical then. He decides that in addition to farming, he'll get into the home manufacture of smoking tobacco. By 1890, Washington Duke Sons and Company had become the biggest cigarette manufacturer in the nation. About that same time, they opened a branch in New York, and Buck Duke then takes the lead in organizing the American Tobacco Company.
All little people take the hat off to me because I'm a ragtime millionaire.
Duke's success as a tobacco manufacturer ultimately shifted major tobacco production from Virginia, especially Danville, Virginia, where the cradle of the auction system was, down into North Carolina. And from that point through World War I, through World War II, tobacco consumption and demand had quite a shot in the arm.
Now, a cigarette that's low in tar and nicotine, high in menthol flavor, new Montclair. Just enough in every puff makes every puff a pleasure. How much is just enough? Just enough menthol to please your taste. Montclair's new charcoal menthol filter does it. Charcoal granules that are both activated and mentholated release just enough menthol to freshen every puff. So every puff tastes as good as the first puff. Smoke Montclair, new from the American Tobacco Company.
I still enjoy the aroma of the dirt when you turn it up in the spring. That's always one of my first remembrances as a kid, is in the spring of the year as you're turning up the dirt and plowing and cultivating. Is you can always smell that smell of the freshly turned soil. I'm a fifth generation farmer here in this community. And all my ancestors, as far back as we can determine it, always grew tobacco here. Right now we farm about 2,200 acres of cleared land. We own about 450 acres of cleared land. Right now this year we'll probably have around 75 acres of tobacco.
The first job I had was following a cultivator tractor and covering plants that my dad would cover up when he was plowing the weeds out. I remember that the first thing that I did when I was probably 4 or 5 years old, walk through the field with my dad and family. It's always been a family operation pretty much everywhere you go.
This particular farm here has been in our family, I know, four generations. My grandfather and my great-grandfather, and my great-great-grandfather before them had raised tobacco. Tobacco's it's a way of life and a tradition. It gets in your blood. Some people don't understand that, but it does, and it gets in you, and it's hard to get out of it.
It was just like a big family, and I was my daddy's helper. Then as I grew older, you know, it got to be something that wasn't so much fun. It really got to be hard work.
Last fall, we come in here from Turning Fly, and we broke this land. Now we've come back this spring, and we've dissed it, and come over and applied herbicides for weed control, and we've come back and what we call bedded it up.
Sometime later, they would put claws on the beds. We drew plants out of the plant bed and planted tobacco.
He had to take a spoon, and everywhere you see grass, you had to take that spoon and dig and put your thumb to it and pull it up. That's the way you got the grass up. And that was hard work.
We used to make them when I was growing up in the woods. Daddy would always go in the woods and we'd clear up a spot, ever how big a spot he would need, and we'd make a plant bed there. And then, of course, we'd progressed up to the greenhouses. I said, if I live long enough to be able to finish school, I'll never farm a day in my life. Hard work. Walking behind a mule, my feet were so sore I couldn't hardly walk, had blisters on them. You walk barefooted a while, and you walk in your sock feet a while, and you put your shoes on, and I said, I'll never do this.
See, what happened, we cut the labor out. Now we don't have to make that bed. We don't have to hire anybody to pull them plants up. We go to the greenhouse and get them right in the tray, lay them right on the trail and go to feed. Go set at night. That cut out all the labor
on pulling them up.
Pulling them up, yeah. And making the bed.
And making the bed.
They used to plant with a peg, then they got the hand planters, and then the planter you would ride come along with a tractor. Probably the last part of this coming week or first week of May, we'll come back with a migrant labor and plant all this right here.
You move out on Penny's farm, plant a little crop of bagger and a little crop of corn. Come around to see you gonna flit and plot till you get yourself a mortgage on everything you got. It's the hard times in the country out on Penny's farm.
We used to just grow regular beds for ourselves. Now we got into this business sort of specializing in growing plants. What would you say, we've got 100 plant customers that buy plants from us?
Yeah, probably over 100 customers buy plants from us. I was born in 1939, on October 18th, and I think my mom had me in the stepping room sometime in November. We didn't have, I don't know, probably 6 or 7 acres back in. I mean, we just growed up. It's just like everyday operation. And whenever you got big enough to help in the biker, you had to help. It's just part of life at that way. And so that's how I was introduced into biker.
When I was a kid, about my own son's age now, I tagged along my dad. And the older you got, the more work you did to it. You were almost doing, you know, an adult's job eventually.
Once it got developed, you'd see a little, what we call a little button top come in it. It'd be about as big as a golf ball. And you see little small suckers coming around the leaf.
Suckers come up and try to make another stalk from the bottom. If you let them get over an inch long, you're in trouble. You got to reach your finger in and pull them out, each one, until you break all the way down the stalk.
Sometime around the 4th of July, something like that, we'll come back and we'll, hopefully it'll be big enough to top, and we'll break the tops out and apply sucker control.
You had to go in there and each individual plant, you go around it and pull the suckers out and you top it, and you could hand top it. Then it came out with toppers, had a blade on it very similar to a lawnmower blade, and it was turning, and it would cut it off, and you top it out, all your plants would be the same height.
Nicotine is made in the root, and once you top the tobacco, then it's translocated up into the leaves and it builds up just like everything else. But that's not the reason that we top per se, is to get higher nicotine. You want all your energy going into the leaf.
The reason we top tobacco to get the flower out is so that the nutrients in the plant will stop going up to make seed. Because what we want is the leaf. Now the seed companies, of course, they'll leave that top in there until it just tops out. But out here on the farm, we cut the top out as soon as possible. The sooner you cut it out, the quicker the nutrients go back into the plant. It'll make the top leaves thicker, heavier, and that's what we're looking for, is weight.
Our family was closely affiliated with Reynolds Tobacco Company, and they're the ones that talked my grandfather in coming down here. Our family was originally from Wilmore, Kentucky. They moved down here to start raising Burley tobacco. There wasn't any Burley here. So our family came down and started introducing the Burley to this region, because Williamson County in Middle Tennessee is very similar to the bluegrass of central Kentucky.
Burley is an air cured, and you'll get a more chocolate and dark reds, more of a red amber colored leaf than you will the bright gold leaf typically.
Burley yields more bases. Flu cured, by contrast, yields more acid in the smoke, factors which influence aroma, taste, and palatability, but cause irritation if not balanced.
I know basically what it takes to get the best dollar out of that stalk of tobacco.
If you're pulling them by hand, tobacco matures from the bottom up. So you would pull the bottom probably 3 or 4 leaves. That's called the primings. Then your next 3 to 4 leaves is called your lugs. Then your next leaves is called your cutters. Then you got your tips in the very top. Tips is the top 2 or 3 leaves. But it's hard to get hand labor to do it now.
I had on a bonnet, it was a homemade bonnet, straw hats. Didn't cover my face like I wanted, so I used the bonnet. And then I had on my dress and long sleeve shirt. Had on gloves. Nobody wore pants then, just wore dresses. Shoes. I guess I wore a hose in the summertime in the field, suckering tobacco and chopping.
A lot of people have gone to harvesters to pull tobacco with, but any country we in right here, it's not as flat as it is in Carolina and stuff, the way you could use a harvester.
A lot of the land in this area here is not suitable for machinery. I mean, those things, you need great big fields and level land.
You know, I've plowed with a horse. A lot of people never plowed with a horse, but I've done that before too. You know, they used to cultivate it all with a horse or a mule to the tractor come around.
This box is called a tobacco sled. And there are, if you look closely, metal runners on the bottom of this. And when we have our tobacco harvest festival in the fall, we bring in a couple of mules. And if you hook up a strong mule to this, they can move it along. This fits right between the rows of tobacco. And so usually the men and boys would go in the field and fill the tobacco sled with the leaves. They bring it back, and you usually have a little kid who would be taking the leaves out, and the child would be handing the leaves to the stringer, and the stringer would be taking the twine and looping them to the stick. It was generally done by a woman or, say, a teenage girl, and it's amazing how fast some people can do it.
Of course, we had to hire somebody to help plant it, and then when we put in tobacco, we had to have somebody, hire somebody to loop it. While we had two children, I had to wash on a scrub board. Everything had to be ironed, a flat iron heated on the stove, and cook and clean up. Something to do all the time.
You cut your tobacco, you split it down the stalk, and then you tied it by hand. Anything you did it by hand. I raised a family on the farm. My dad raised his family on the farm. And I guess you're in your blood, you don't get away from it.
Dad had never farmed a large number of acres. He farmed small. In fact, that tractor right there used to be his. But the way I was trying to do things and farm was different from the way he did it. In 1976 is when I bought my first tobacco harvester. Well, he didn't want me to buy it. He wanted to do hand labor continue. He said, boy, that thing will never pull tobacco. It'll tear it all to pieces. You're making a mistake. Well, I knew the mistake was that you couldn't get hand labor no more. So I bought one. Well, we went to the field and he went to the field. He couldn't wait, went to the field. Went up and down, he shook his head, he went back to the house. He couldn't stand it.
Sometimes it takes 2 days just to pull one barn. We got 73-year-old man and a 70-year-old man and us two. And we got one driver and we pull it and we come to the barn and put it in. And can't find any help, you know, anymore.
I remember when you get labor, all you wanted for 50 cents an hour.
Not have to go far to get it either, did
you? What are you talking about? People was begging you wanting to work.
Now you got to bring it from Mexico.
Yeah, we have a Hispanic labor population. That's about all we use. My dad and I and my brother helps a little bit. But the vast majority of the physical labor is done by Hispanic laborers.
We have these three guys help us during the summer. They're from southern Mexico, I mean, right almost to the very border of southern Mexico, which I think one of them said it would take him 5 days to get home.
Man, I can show you people all over, from Arkansas, North Carolina, Tennessee, all the way up here in Kentucky that feels the same way about any guy that when you hire a guy that will work with you, regardless of who he is, that you find good relations.
Esos viajes que tenemos de Nayarit a Guadalajara, Jalisco, Guadalajara, Jalisco a Monterrey, Monterrey, Laredo, Laredo, Kentucky.
Where we are, it's no local labor available, manual labor. So we have to depend on the migrant workers to harvest our crop.
I ain't got along with all the migrant workers that perfect. When one won't do something or wants to illegally do things, I'll call his hand. I don't want him.
Pues comisiona así por alguien que, digamos que para que encontrar el trabajo no, pero tenemos una contratista a la que le otorgamos más o menos como $35 porque ella nos haga el trámite de papel para nosotros ya nomás llegar al consulado y recibir la visa.
Por el patrón. Por él me contrató porque antes me había conocido, anteriormente había conocido. Antes yo había venido a trabajar para él, pero no con visa, había venido a trabajar de ilegal antes. Después él me conoció y por medio de él se puso en contacto conmigo y me pidió que si quería venir contratado con visa.
I know that whenever a guy leaves home and he leaves his wife and his family for 4 or 5 months, it's tough now. It's really tough. So you try to do a little bit for him to not make it totally disastrous.
Yo tengo desde, son que 8 meses, 8 meses y medio, 9. Desde marzo estoy aquí. Ya se nos vence hasta el 20 de diciembre. Ya lo que se termina la visa, ya nos regresamos para México.
They're like everyone else. I mean, they're trying to make a living and working hard.
You go in the field, you work all day. Wave the night, but you get no pay. Promise to meet our little bucket of lard. It's hard to be a runner on Penny's farm. It's hard times in the country, out on Penny's farm.
I've always enjoyed it, and when I graduated high school, I knew that was what I wanted to do, and I went straight into the tobacco business. I had a college thing set up, supposed to go to Virginia Tech, and had a fully paid scholarship to go to Virginia Tech for agribusiness, and it had come my time to take over the farm pretty much, I had to make a decision what I wanted to do. And, it was in me, is all I've ever done. I've never done anything but farm. And so I decided to stay here and grow tobacco, hoping that, it was going to be a good future. And it has been. I can't complain. I've got a lot of good out of it. But it's done got to the point to where, we're not making any money off of it anymore.
I help my grandson plant tobacco. I enjoy it, and people say, why on this earth do you want to do that? I said, because I don't ever want to forget where I came from and how I grew up. And even though I don't have to do it now, I love to do it. And it really means something to me. My childhood memories are fond to me today, and I've tried to salvage some memorabilia as well as those memories. My grandchildren will want to know something about their, ancestors and things that was done differently from what they are now. And everything that I could, I kept. So if you want to come on down, I'll show you my little items of memorabilia. I collect everything that anybody, that most other people don't want. But I like it. Cigar boxes. I paid $2 for this one. I remember this from my father. This was down at the house. And I hope it's still got the... It has the tobacco in it, and I have no idea how old that is. And this is the tobacco planter. Somebody would drop the leaves, and you would plant it. And you would go out the road. This is a picture of Christopher's grandfather. And this is Christopher. This was in our local paper. It says the White Oak 63, 10-7 acres in Callens area, help of his grandson Christopher. I can remember when I was a kid, I'd go with my daddy to the barn and fire was put up in the fire boxes and the smoke came out of the flues.
George Penner Reynolds, they'll come into town with the hands in the pockets and the hair hanging down. Go in the store and the merchant will say, your mortgage is due and I'm looking for my pay. It's a hard times in the country, out on Penner's farm.
This barn hadn't been used probably in 40 years, at least 40. This barn wasn't even in operation when I started farming, I don't think. It's about the hardest work I ever done, but as far as the back is concerned, what we did, we put it on sticks and then got up here and hung it. That's what we did. One man up down, the man on the ground passes them up to you, then you hang them all the way. That's the way we had to do it, all hand work. It was all on a stick.
You can see there's a lot of old wood barns around here, but most of them's getting in pretty bad shape.
You put your flues up and start the fire under it, get up all hours of the night and put in wood.
Then they came out with oil burners. And one of the brand names of that was a Buckeye burner, which was a burnt kerosene.
They got one called Buckeye, and they got one called Mayo. But these here are cure. This thing would put out heat, and that's what cured tobacco, four burners.
Well, Papa Grade, the first tobacco you ever grew. Somebody showed you how to grade it, that's the way he did it. You put the best grade in this rack. It was a rack, you know, and had stobs in between like this. You just laid each grade into a rack. There was tobacco in your lap, and take it out and lay the whatever leaf belong here, whatever leaf belong there, about four or five grades.
And today, we're taking it out of a box and running it over into a baler, into a square bale, putting 900 pounds in a bale. And, you know, it's hardly any grading going on.
In the early 70s is when it came out with bulk tobacco barns, and they were either fuel burnt or either gas. That's what they have now is what they call the bulk barn, which is put tobacco in it in bulk.
We got about 7 more barns out. We used to sit around old stick barn at nighttime and kill back. We used to sit back in the old rocking chair, sit back with an old peace pipe in your mouth, tobacco pipe, some of this kind of tobacco right here. Just crumb it up and put in your pipe and smoke it.
The major difference in the way we cure now and years ago, in the old stick barns, we called it, used wooden sticks, that was a natural flow of air. You heated air at the bottom of the barn, and that hot air would just naturally rise through the tobacco and kill it out as it got hotter. This here is forced air all the time. There's a fan in the back, and if you don't force the air through it, the tobacco will rot. The fan here circulates air through the barn continuously under pressure. And you just set your temperature here by this dial. You set it on 90, you set this dial, say, to 120, and every hour, 5 degrees, it'll gradually creep up. I call it checking for swell stems. You cool it down from 160 degrees to about 100 degrees. And if you want to be real sure that everything's cured out or completely cured, I'll go in and stick my hand in the box from 4 to 6 inches deep and check to see if there are any stems that are still got moisture in them. This here had a lot of drowned tobacco in it. It was withered up. And it lays too close together, the air can't get through it. And I wanted to be sure that it was dead.
Flue cured tobacco, they can just put it in there and dry it down and control the chemical reactions a lot better than we can. We just have to take what nature beats out, and if we get a lot of wet, high humidity weather, then the curing process occurs too slow.
Kentucky still grows a lot more barley than Tennessee. It's a very prominent crop for them. Now this one, the yield. Bob Miller, he's probably one of the premier tobacco breeders in the world.
For burley tobacco, we have the best curing conditions in the world. If you look at a crop in Brazil, it looks outstanding, but they have a lot of trouble curing that tobacco because they don't have enough humidity. You want enough humidity in there, you don't want the tobacco to just dry, it has to cure. It goes through a process every night that the tobacco it'll dry out during the day, and then we call it coming in case or coming in order. It'll absorb moisture during the night, the moisture comes back out of the midribs, and so that tobacco goes through a drying process basically on a 24-hour period, and every time it sets the color and these chemical reactions that are starches and sugars are being transformed.
We got it cured on the stalk, and the tobacco companies has always liked our tobacco.
Cut it and spike it on a wooden stick and let it cure a little in the field.
Then we'll let it stay in the barn probably 60 days, and we'll start stripping it.
And then you take it down and manually strip it, put it in a bale and tie it.
You want enough humidity to get the curing process, to have the tobacco cure, to have the flavor and aroma that makes our tobacco special. But if you get too high of humidity, then you have the problem with the nitrosamines being formed, which are carcinogens, and we're trying to reduce that in tobacco every way we can.
I have the last pack of cigarettes that my sister smoked before she died. I've got the last cigarette pack my husband had before he died, and the last pack that my son smoked before he died.
At Philip Morris USA, we have a goal to be the most responsible manufacturer and marketer of consumer products. In order for us to make progress against that goal, it is very important that we align ourselves with society's expectations of a manufacturer of a product that causes serious disease.
I quit smoking because I'm a diabetic.
I kept having colds and bronchitis and everything else, and the doctor told me, he said, as long as you're smoking, you're gonna keep having it. He said, you need to quit.
I still don't think there's anything wrong with cigarette smoking. If you know that it's bothering you, then you should quit. But most anything else that's used out of moderation in life will kill you. And I just think the way the tobacco industry has been treated and the farmer has been treated has been almost, I would say, a disgrace. Now, I know there's a lot of people died from cancer, and they say from smoking. My husband died from lung cancer, but I do not think that the cigarettes was any more cause of him dying from lung cancer than a lot of other reasons.
I blame the tobacco industry for those deaths. Tobacco is a highly addictive substance, more addictive than heroin.
I don't like to make something that would harm anybody, which I know it does to a certain extent. I don't lay awake at night worrying about it.
It's not that we really like to raise tobacco. I'm gonna just put that away. It's a lot easier to set up in an air-conditioned combine and pick corn and beans, you know, and just drive to the market and all that. But anywhere from the last 15 years or longer, that's from 60 to 70% of our gross income off this farm has been tobacco.
Some would argue that the colonies wouldn't have even been a profitable venture for the British but for tobacco. It was the number one export crop for the young country, or actually before it was a country, back to England. I know there are tobacco leaves painted on the capital in several different places. So it was an integral part of the beginning of the United States.
It was like owning some stock. You could sell it, you could lease it, it had value. We call them the quota.
Tobacco quotas have been around for 2-3 generations now. They're figured as a value to your property. They're owned by the farms and the people that own them. To have them just marked off and written off and no compensation would be like, you know, having your property devalued for no reason and cost you money.
During the New Deal, the federal government went around and assessed the current growing history per farm throughout the tobacco belt and established a quota that could be grown on those farms. That quota became an asset that was attached to the ground, affected the land values, could be bought and sold. For the farmers, it stabilized the prices. For the manufacturers, it guaranteed this supply and, you know, worked rather well.
It was a salvation for farmers because back years ago, we didn't have that. And then in the 30s, they came out with a stabilization program and the grading service. And ever since then, it has worked very, very efficient.
The thing about most of all tobacco here and all throughout North Carolina is basically every little farm just about has a tobacco allotment on it, which it's been cut. It's less, way less than 50% of what it used to be. And now just for anyone to grow any tobacco of any scale, you got to rent all these little farms or rent all these little allotments to get any kind of volume to make it justifiable to farm now.
Quotas have gotten so small, we're doing a lot of 200, 300, 400 pound leases. We have to contact a lot of people to get 50,000 pounds of tobacco.
Yeah, I understand.
The quota that I got is probably, on our 5 farms that we got, it's probably like 10,000 pounds. And we're leasing in 150,000 to 180,000 pounds. So it's just a constant job being on the phone and trying to figure out, you know, which one's going to let you have it. And then it's just competitive because you got to lease it and bid against the other people that's leasing. And you know you have to quit your bid when you know you ain't going to make no money.
Tobacco farmers have lost over 50% of their income. And, you know, for a government controlled program, that's just unheard of.
If nothing happens this year, these farmers will be forced to give up all that they have. After 6 years of loaning on collateral, there's nothing left for the banks to do except foreclose.
It goes back to a price-driven world market we're in. It's such a global economy we're in that, you know, what happens in Brazil or Zimbabwe at a time years ago, we didn't realize it would affect us like it does today, but we're in such a global economy that now we realize it. We realize we got to change with the world market when the world changes.
Agriculture's treated in general by politicians as, I don't know how to word it exactly. There's not enough of us left in agriculture production to really carry a lot of political clout. Is it like 1.5% or a shade under is actively involved in agriculture now? We don't carry enough political clout with votes to really sway the people.
You think about it. Any time that you just don't give a man a choice and take what he's got from him, freedom's gone.
This may sound like rhetoric to some, but it is the precise truth for countless thousands of farm families. I've been there to see it time and again, and I could not be more serious about this. I am dead serious about this. Status quo is simply not an option.
To capture $10 billion and to send it to only a handful of states in a legislative body in which every state is represented is almost impossible. Mr. President, I was rim-racked by the two big newspapers in our state. They said I'd turned my back on Kentucky culture. I'd gone Washington. I'd been up there so long, I'd sort of forgotten what it was like in the hollers and in the tobacco fields of Kentucky. And I was criticized by the Farm Bureau and the Burley Tobacco Co-op and all the establishment. How could you possibly be for a buyout? I took a survey of tobacco growers. I got a pollster and I said, let's go out and ask them how they feel about it. And frankly, they were against it too. 50% of them were against it. About 35% of them were for it. So the whole tobacco establishment in Kentucky was against a buyout in 1998 when I first advocated it. Now I would say, Mr. President, I'm treated as a visionary.
If there is a buyout, if the quota system goes away for some reason, we would like to get back into it and probably grow 100,000, 150,000 pounds again.
With the stabilization in place, we're guaranteed a fair market price. We don't know what's going to happen if this buyout comes and we no longer have that stabilization net that takes care of it.
Colleagues have heard me say on many occasions that I think it's always important to be advocating policies and ideas that promote freedom, that promote job opportunities, and improve the competitiveness of America. And that's why I think we must equitably find a way to end this tobacco quota system.
Fortunately, we were able to find a bill that needed to pass, an international tax bill, that was moving on the House side. And there were 30 House members, 20 Republicans and 10 Democrats from tobacco producing districts, who basically leveraged their support for the international tax bill to get the buyout in.
Senator McConnell's office said they could shut it down and it'd be 6 hours before they reopened, and that was sometime up in night on Thursday night. And Friday morning, the paper said that the buyout was through. It was a done deal.
The buyout bill will make payments of almost $10 billion to quota holders and growers over a 10-year period.
At the risk of sounding a little bit immodest, we pulled off a legislative coup. It was very difficult to achieve. Had it cost the federal government anything, we would not have been able to do it.
Well, the real beneficiary are the tobacco companies themselves. So it winds up being a Band-Aid for the tobacco farmer and the tobacco grower, and a jackpot for the tobacco industry.
I think it is ridiculous to suggest that the government sending the tobacco companies a bill for $10.1 billion was to their advantage.
We've got one of the smallest crops in history of growing tobacco in the U.S. under this program that we're under now. We're not hardly at 1 billion pounds a year, but we're round about numbers. We're pretty close. If the tobacco companies save 35 cents a pound on 1 billion pounds, you know, that's pretty close to $350 million for no work. That's a pretty good return on the buyout program for them.
When a man gets at my age and you take my quota away from him, that just puts me out. I'm out of the tobacco business.
Whether they buy it out or not, it won't make any difference. I'm not going to let them dictate now what I'm going to do. We're going to make up our decision, our mind, what we're going to do, and the government and the companies can go on their own.
There will be fewer people producing tobacco in the United States, and there will be larger farms. Now, frankly, that was happening even with the program.
I got the evil get out. The evil I got to get bigger. That's the way it's going to be.
Like any free market activity, this is a time for creativity. And it'll be really interesting to see how those who want to stay in the field respond to the fact that they're now in a highly competitive international business. And I'm not surprised that farmers like the Elliots could simply move into and enhance areas that they're already involved in.
This year could be our last year. Farm credit, we borrow $500,000 a year to operate on. And it gets... when you got almost two-thirds or three-fourths of it in out in the field, it's some sleepless nights.
Once your tobacco is harvested and cured, you take it to the warehouse. This is really as much as the barnyard, the breeding grounds for tobacco culture, and has been that way since 1858 when the loose leaf system started in Danville.
And I remember as a kid, Dad loading the tobacco up in the Model A car and put everything he had in the Model A car, and then sometime he tied a road wagon to the car and went to town to haul his tobacco crop.
We had a nice tobacco market in Ahoskie. We had farmers and we had Bass Night Warehouse booth.
Opening day was a big day. The whole family would go sometime because that was the first time you had any money to come in.
I would try to go with my dad. He and I would go quite frequently. My brother, he would go with us as well. We all had a vested interest in it. We'd all get a little money sometimes.
There were several warehouses. At one time, Greenville had 9 warehouses. When I first started there years ago, they had 9. They don't have any now. When I first started back here in 1989, we had 2 warehouses. Now there's only 1 left, and that's our market here.
From the time it opened in July until it closed, mostly in November, especially in the flue-cured belt, the tobacco warehouse was the watering hole. It was the gathering point. It was the entertainment center. It was open a lot of times 24 hours a day. The kids would play, run up and down the rows of tobacco, run up and down on top of the piles of tobacco. Sometimes you'd find a farmer who didn't want a young'un running up and down, and he'd run him off.
The various towns had developed tobacco warehouses where farmers brought their tobacco and auctioneers sold it. The tobacco auctioneer had a rather musical chant, and most people couldn't understand it because he spoke so rapidly.
After the Civil War, the volume of tobacco that was going through the marketplace then was such that you had to sell tobacco at a rapid pace. A man named Lee Aubrey Riggs came along, and he became known as Speed Riggs, and Speed began auctioneering in Durham at Liberty Tobacco Warehouse. And everybody from Speed Riggs' time until today tried to mimic him. They tried to copy Speed's chant. The auctioneers who came in to focus post-World War II are the best tobacco auctioneers who ever were. Bum Bum Leggetts, Red Cat McLaughlin, Dancing Jakey Taylor, just to name a few. But Smokey Joe Burnett was, without a doubt, the best tobacco auctioneer who ever lived. He was from Buffalo Springs, Virginia. Joe had a deep, deep bass voice. He was a very tall, good-looking, sandy-haired man. He could walk into a warehouse, and if an auctioneer saw him or anybody recognized him, it within a matter of a minute or two or three, he'd be on sale. The buyers were like putty in his hands. Everybody loved it.
When I came to Durham in 52, tobacco was still thriving, and Durham still had, I forget how many tobacco warehouses. And you could smell tobacco in Durham, and it was a smell of money.
Opening day, in the good old days, it would be 700-800 people in the warehouse. Bankers, lawyers, everybody in the community would come to the warehouse. But now you don't see any farmers, and we can have tobacco all over the place. The festivity is gone, the notoriety is gone, the excitement is gone. Instead of selling the old-fashioned way like 94, $4.94, $4.94, $93, $3.94, $94 export, we do it by handheld computers now, and it's very quiet, very somber, no excitement, and rather dull.
Each buyer has his own independent PDA, which he holds in his hand. If he thinks it should be more, he can press the button and move it up, or he can press the button and move it down. I love the old auction way. I like this way as well. Change comes. You accept it, or you're left behind. I'm probably one of the oldest auctioneers that's operating the machines now. And I'm just thankful that I still have a job. There's a lot of them that don't.
It was great, you know, 20, 30 years ago, but the way farming has gotten and the way things are going, it's just more or less an antiquated system. We're contracted with Philip Morris, and we're basically growing whatever, how many pounds Philip Morris tell us they want from us. Before we had quotas and allotments, we don't have that now, but yet we don't feel like we can really sell more than what they determined for us to grow for them.
We've not purchased any tobacco through the auction system for the past several years. We acquire most of our tobacco by contracting directly with tobacco farmers.
Now that we've shifted into contract, still a friendly atmosphere, but you back up to the warehouse, they unload your tobacco, run it down a sale line, and usually you're gone in a couple of hours and you're cleared and have your check and you're going home. It's not as much a social event.
I lost 37 cents a pound by taking it to the warehouse compared to I did if I took it to the contract, and it's just survivory. I mean, that money was needed to pay bills and around. Didn't have it.
In a typical year, we will purchase, Philip Morris USA will purchase about 50% of all of the tobacco grown in the United States. The tobacco leaves are separated, the stem is removed from the tobacco leaf, and then the tobacco is packed in large tobacco hogsheads. It is then transported to tobacco warehouses near our cigarette manufacturing facilities in Richmond, Virginia, in Cabarrus County, North Carolina. It then remains in storage for about 2 years before we use it for cigarette production. There are some styles of tobacco that we buy overseas that we feel also contribute to our blend.
We still grow the best tobacco in the world, but it's also the most expensive tobacco in the world. I can just about count on one hand the number of young guys in the two counties here we live in that, you know, coming back home and farm.
It's a virtual certainty that you will have fewer farmers and bigger farms in order to try to compete in a global market.
I'm actually ready to get out. Yeah, I'm just going to back right out and give it to somebody else. When they told us they were going to take the quota away from us, we didn't realize this would be our last year.
I think about how old this country is. When they came here, the Indians were growing tobacco. And somehow, I just feel like it's meant to be. I don't feel like it's meant to be abolished. Now, I know scientists and politicians and everything, you know, they may not agree with me, but you know, you feel what you feel, and to me, it's a part of this country and has helped many poor people get above water.
They regulate cyanide unless it's found in a cigarette. How crazy and absurd is this? It's insane. So let's make Congress support strong FDA regulation of tobacco that really has heart.
I can see in myself in time that we may not have the opportunity to raise tobacco, but it's a legal crop, and it's been making us money for, in my farm operation that I know with my dad and all, for 80 years. We've raised it, we're good at it, and we know how to do it, and it's and it was some way of making money. And with these hills and hollers that we got, we not can't be big grain farmers.
My son, when he finished school, he didn't know what he wanted to do. So I said, well, if you want to come and work with me and I pay you about a week for a year and see how you like it. If you like it, then you can, you know, come aboard and we'll farm together. And I thought that he would continue on. And I approached him when we came back just after Christmas and told him that I just want to slow up and I'd let him have more responsibility. He just flat out told me, he said, Daddy said, if you want to slow up, I want to quit. He said, I've had all that I want.
Tobacco you can do without. But peanuts, corn, soybeans, they're going to have to be here because folks are going to have to eat. So I'm looking more in that range now than I am the tobacco.
Beans and corn will not pay the bills. And now losing the tobacco, that's all I had to depend on.
Every evening, I ride through the farms and look. And mornings or evenings when I go home, I look. And I constantly keep a check on it. And I see other people working. And in one sense, I said, I wish it was me. In another sense, I said, well, I'm glad it's not.